there he is.
Hey, everyone.
Welcome, Sinan.
Thank you. Thanks very much for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here, although only remotely. I wish I could be there in person. Today, just what I wanted to do is to give you guys a bit of a beginning, to lay out some fundamentals on the table, so to speak, so that as you go through the day, hear other speakers talk about applied problems in networks or how they're applying technology to solve different tricky puzzles in the world, that you have a basic understanding of how the structure of networks evolved and evolves and how that relates to things like creativity, innovation, access to information, productivity, and so on. And I wanted to really just start with the basic building blocks of networks and work you up to a few pieces of knowledge that might help you in those conversations. So as you see on this, on my first slide here, this is the Facebook, the entire Facebook network as of December 2010. A very, very complex structure, now approaching 2 billion people that are connected in day-to-day interaction with one another. And it spans the entire globe, as is obvious from this slide. But on the next slide, what you'll see is that these networks have very specific and complex structures. And if you think of the links in a network as guiding the flow of resources, of social capital, of information, of ideas, of trends, and so on, then the way that these resources and information and creativity flow through human society is guided in large part by networks, by who we know, by who we talk to, who we collaborate with, and how we structure those collaborations. Let me start by giving you a few examples of this network structure so that we can get sort of a mental image of the different types of structures that might exist. This slide here is a slide showing the structure of the interdisciplinary collaboration network at the Santa Fe Institute. And they're colored, the nodes are colored, these are people, and each of them have a different color for their theoretical area. So there's one for the structure of RNA, one for statistical physics, one for mathematical ecology, one for agent-based models. And you notice immediately that they are sort of grouping into groups amongst one another that are talking more to one another than to others outside of the group. In the next slide, you'll see a high school friendship network, where the nodes are colored by the year of their, which year they are in high school, so junior, senior, you know, freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior year. And you again start to notice a little bit the separation of the different types of people in terms of how they're cooperating. Now, that's a high school friendship network, but in the next slide, what you'll see is a high school dating network. And if we click forward twice, you'll see a couple of notes that I've made about this network. The first one is that the structure of the dating network and the friendship network are very, very different, obviously. This one has almost a tree-like structure, whereas if you think about the friendship network, it was much more complete in the sense that many more people were friends with each other than there are people who are dating one another. And if you see this this tree-like network, it comes from the fact that people tend to, in general, be monogamous, to be dating one person at a time. It's also clear from the colors that these typically go boy-girl, boy-girl. But if you look closely, there are a number of places where that's not true, reflecting same-sex couples. Some people have many more dating partners than others, and you see that variation, but you immediately begin to notice how social structure can tell us so much about how social groups are organized, how information flows, and how influence might spread through these networks. On the next slide, you can see that we can actually map these information flows. If you advance one more, you'll see a note about how we map these information flows. And this is the phone call traffic network at a global media firm, just one small bit of it, where the thickness of the lines are More frequent communication between two employees, and the direction indicates who's calling whom. And when we analyze things like call log networks, we can see exactly how information is flowing through a network. In the next slide, you'll see another example of this, which is an email network at an executive recruiting firm. There you see, if you advance once more, that location matters a great deal. This company is organized into a central office in the middle with multiple satellite offices with just a few representatives in each office. And the communication that happens within this company is very much guided by geography in addition to the information needs and the different types of people that work there. Now, let me take you into the building blocks of network structure and how human networks evolved into what we know today. To really understand that, we begin with what Granovetter called the forbidden triangle. And if you advance to see the text there, what you'll see is that the basic theory of Granovetter's forbidden triangle is that if A has a strong tie to B, and if A also has a strong tie to C, then that dotted line between B and C indicates that it's very likely that B and C have at least a weak tie. And why is this the case? The reason for this is because if A is good friends with B and good friends with C, B and C are very likely to be in the same social circle, to bump into one another because they're hanging out with B. If A likes B, then they probably have very similar preferences to B. And if A likes C, they probably have similar preferences to B. So B and C are going to have similar interests, similar preferences. They're going to have a reason to want to be together. Another good reason why they're likely to be friends is because if they're not friends, that's going to create a lot of social discord between A being friends with B and A being friends with C. Each of them will say, why are you friends with C? You know, I don't like C, and so on and so forth. So all of these social factors make it highly likely that B and C will eventually become friends. And if you advance one more, you'll see what this what the term that describes this, which is triadic closure. Human networks are replete with triadic closure. As A is friends with B and B is friends with C, B and C become friends, and this creates what's seen on this slide, clustering in networks. What you see in human social networks are clumps or clusters of people that are densely connected within, and if you advance one more, they are loosely connected across by what are called weak bridging ties. And this is true of every single social network of human beings that has ever been studied. And it is just sort of a structure of human networks that is ubiquitous. In the next slide, what you see is an example of how these networks look when you consider the forbidden triangle and this this tendency to cluster. You see cliques that are bunches of human beings connected together deeply within, with weak ties connecting them across. This is a co-authorship graph of academics publishing together. In the next slide, what you see is biotech collaborations amongst firms and university labs at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, the Children's Medical Center Corporation, and so on. And again, you see this clustering pattern become evident in even these types of collaborations. In the next slide, what you see is that this is even true of our individual networks. This is Owen Mundy's Facebook graph. He's a sociologist who wrote a paper, and he put his own Facebook graph in the paper, in the study. And what you see there is distinct communities of people that he knows. For instance, his University of California at San Diego community where he did his graduate study, or his Florida State community where he teaches, or his family community, his high school community, and his undergraduate community at Indiana University. And all of us have these types of networks that are clustered, and that has tremendous implications for how we collaborate and how we share information. In the next slide, you see the result of this clustering. So what human beings are characterized by in their human social networks are high clustering, as you see in the top part of the graph, but very low path lengths, as you see in the bottom part of the graph. And this was shown by Duncan Watts and Steve Strogatz in 1998 as a fundamental property of human social networks. Very high clustering, but low path lengths. And that's made possible by these cliques of people that are connected together by these weak bridging ties that keeps the path lengths between any two people in the human social network short, but keeps the level of clustering very high. In the next slide, you'll see another example of this, which is a Norwegian network of interlocking board director members of different companies. Again, you see this clustering. These are clusters that are connected by weak bridging ties. And this structure that is born of the forbidden triad creates what we now know as 6 degrees of separation. Because of those short path lengths, we can get to anyone in the world by 6 degrees of separation. It also creates what's known as the strength of weak ties, because those weak bridging ties are what hold the human social network together and what enable information flow and collaboration flow and idea flow across that network to different cliques in the network. In the next slide, you see another consequence of this high clustering and low path lengths. If you advance one more, you'll see what you would expect is a bell curve of a degree distribution. A degree distribution is just a distribution of the number of links everyone has in the network. You might expect that this is bell curves, that most nodes have an average number. There are some highly connected nodes and some very lowly connected nodes, but most have an average number. But given high clustering and low path lengths, what we actually have is on the right-hand side, we have power law degree distributions. There are very many nodes with only a few links, and there are only a few hubs with a large number of links, and those are the very popular people, the people who know everyone, and so forth. In the next slide, you'll again see a typology of individual networks, which shows you that our friends cluster into these densely connected clusters within and sparsely connected clusters without. There's a college network, a high school network, a family network, or a neighborhood network. And in the next slide, you begin to see some of the consequences of this. If you advance a couple of times and see the words, you'll see that in addition to clustering, what we know about human social networks is that the clusters separate people with similar knowledge and information. So I've color-coded a hypothetical network here in different colors to indicate areas of expertise. And typically what you see is that people with the same area of expertise cluster together, and they're separated by these weak bridging ties to other clusters who have different areas of expertise. What does this mean? It means that the value of information that's shared in a network comes from its uneven distribution across the local network neighborhoods. Each local network neighborhood gets deep in its subject matter, but doesn't know much about another neighborhood. So connection to these diverse neighborhoods gives you access to novel pools of information, and this novel information is valuable due to its local scarcity. If I know somebody in another neighborhood that knows the solution to my problem, but I'm the only one in my cluster that knows it, that information is very valuable to my cluster, and I can help my team by bringing that over from the other cluster. This gives actors with scarce novel information brokerage opportunities and ability to create innovation in a network. In the next slide, what you see is an example of these brokerage opportunities. Here again, if you advance a couple more, you see these clusters that have different expertise, and the red node in the middle is a broker that connects these clusters and facilitates the flow of information to solve locally intractable problems with knowledge coming from the outside that represents out-of-the-box thinking. In the next slide, you'll see just an example, which shows here's a person on the left with four friends. But all of those friends know each other. And here's a person on the right, again, with the same number of friends, four friends, but none of them knows one another. So the person on the right has contacts to many different pools of information. The person on the left is swimming in the same pool of information as all the people that they know. In the next slide, you see the consequences of the tensions between these two structures. The highly cohesive, strong tie network on the left gives you more information, but more redundant information. It's more trusted relationships. It's more resilient, more tight-knit, but also more homogenous thinking and may create groupthink. The network on the right, you get less information because those are weak ties, but you get more novel information per unit of information that you receive. You have arm's length relationships. These are brittle. They could be broken by too much time not talking to one another over time. They're loosely coordinated, but they're also very diverse and independent, which gives you a bit of a wisdom of crowds effect. And if you go to the last slide, I'll just describe how dynamics play into this situation. If I'm the person who has the four friends, and I can create a network of cohesive, strong ties, or a network of diverse, weak bridging ties, I will get different benefits for myself and my team from these different networks. And I can change my network in order to facilitate what I'm trying to achieve. So on the left-hand side, you see the cohesive network with strong high bandwidth ties, and I've noted there that this is a very good network for exploiting solutions that we already know about. It's efficient. It works well. People are very much in contact. They're all highly tightly coordinated with one another. And this is great for pounding through on incremental innovation. On the right, what you see is much more that the diverse, low bandwidth, weak bridging tie network is much more effective at exploring, finding new out-of-the-box innovative solutions and breakthrough innovations. And I'll just end by saying that my point on this slide is that form follows function. If you are trying to set up a network for a particular purpose, it's important to consider how the structure of that network is going to help you achieve different types of goals, for instance, exploiting or exploring incremental innovation or breakthrough innovation. Like Letha said, there's no one correct network. You have to match the form to the function to succeed. Thank you guys very much. I very much look forward to the discussion and the Q&A later on today.